New at 5:30, a quiet and unusual Easter Sunday held a big surprise for a young girl from the North Shore.
WGN's Mike Lowe is live in Wilmette tonight with more. Mike?
Tamon and Jackie, there were no church services, no Easter egg hunts, no restaurants booked for brunch, but there was a different type of gathering here in Wilmette for a special little girl whose brave fight has inspired her friends.
The bells were ringing out for Easter morning. But like the church itself, Wilmette's brick roads were empty. A certain sense of isolation filled the North Shore suburb, but like an Easter egg, the day would hold a surprise for a special little girl.
She has no idea.
6-year-old Briar Johnston is getting ready to go to the hospital for cancer treatment. You might call this the ultimate Easter egg. A surprise holiday parade down Ashland Avenue.
A bunch of cars.
Millions of cars.
It provided the perfect substitute for the hugs and high fives she would normally get from friends.
We can't hug her and come close to her, so we're having a parade.
We can't wrap our arms around her, right? But this is like the biggest hug we could give her.
The parade, led by the Wilmette Police and Fire Departments, stretched for 4 blocks. It was symbolic of Briar's journey and the support she's seen along the way.
We have a huge community that's behind us. They're with her every single day, and it gives her hope, but the funny thing about the journey that we've been on is she gives all of us all hope, too.
Last year, Briar was diagnosed with neuroblastoma, a solid tumor cancer that most commonly occurs in young children. The St. Francis School kindergartner undergoes treatment every 21 days. And every time she goes to Lurie Children's Hospital, she sends her signature positive vibes back out into the world, giving everyone 2 thumbs up. That courage earned her the nickname Briar the Brave.
Why do they call you Briar the Brave?
Because I'm so brave.
Because you are doing a really hard thing, right? Tell us what you have to do this week.
Where are you going on Tuesday?
Stem cell
transplant, right? For how long?
A month.
But even the bravest among us sometimes need a little boost.
Briar, through this whole thing, has had a smile on her face and the bravest face and bravest foot forward.
And I'm really glad she's my friend.
During this pandemic, so much is unfamiliar, but that doesn't take away the beauty of the unexpected.
I couldn't believe it. I burst into tears. It's just, it is the amount of love you feel is just, it's just so special. And it gives us the strength to keep going.
And Briar will be heading to Lurie Children's Hospital on Tuesday for that stem cell transplant. And of course, she clearly will be taking with her the warm embrace of her Wilmette community. Reporting live this evening in Wilmette, Mike Lowe, WGN News.
And I like these rocky sculptures.
Alone in Millennium Park.
I came here in a little space of my own here.
Kevin Iromlu sat in one of Chicago's most public places contemplating his isolation.
These places, that they are meaningless without the people. It's sad that they see that this problem that we're facing is affecting everyone's life so gravely.
This is Chicago.
I've never lived through anything like this.
In the time of the COVID-19 pandemic.
A ghost town is empty.
LaSalle Street, the symbolic center of the city's economy, was nearly deserted when it would normally be bustling at 9:30 on Monday morning. But Madu Mangombe,
I'm a courier,
pushed on.
I still have to pay my bills, I still have to grocery shop. My life's not gonna stop just because the virus is going on.
Trying not to get caught up in the panic of it all and just trusting that things will work itself out.
You know, you just gotta bite the bullet and keep going, right?
And so it was on every corner.
Are you worried about the coronavirus?
No, not really.
People seemed to be searching for a way forward.
Not much point sitting in a room all day.
Janice and Glenn Hampton are visiting from Australia.
Waiting to see what happens, and we may fly home if we can get a flight home.
There were birds at the bean, but not people.
There's a fence around us.
100 feet away from it. You can't even get near it to touch it or none.
Chicago closed the iconic sculpture to discourage the usual large crowds from congregating there. L platforms were empty, and the corner bars and restaurants, the city's cornerstones, promised only contactless service after they all closed to the public today.
I'm just trying to be able to pay my workers a normal wage.
Teresa Ging's sweet shop Sugar Bliss is closing its Wabash Avenue location, and she wonders why all retailers aren't being asked to do the same thing.
There's going to be another pandemic, and if they don't learn from this, it's going to be even worse.
The Loop looked like it was being looted.
Came into work today and I thought it would just be like a normal day.
As office workers were told to bring their desktop computers home and work in isolation.
So I have a laptop, but the work that I do, I need like a big screen, so it's really just easier to use like a bigger monitor, and that's why everyone's been kind of taking their whole desktop home.
Others had no work to bring home.
We both lost our jobs.
These friends were stocking up on groceries and supplies while they still have money.
2 months? I'm probably be crawling back to my mommy and daddy in Colorado, baby.
And for Kevin Iromu,
it is not a happy moment.
Alone at Millennium Park, there is much to see in what's missing.
The fear in the faces of people, there is not much we can do other than to take care of ourselves and don't let the problem expand further.
Mike Lowe is live in Milwaukee with the latest. Mike.
Robin and Larry, good morning to both of you. We are learning this morning that the shooter was armed with two handguns, one of which was equipped with a silencer. What we still don't know this morning is the motive behind this attack. The Old Miller Brewery is a Milwaukee icon.
This Miller Brewing site has been part of the Miller family and part of the city of Milwaukee for 165 years. And this is the saddest day that we have had.
And on Wednesday, it became the scene of a mass murder.
Remain calm. There's a critical situation, active shooter on campus.
Authorities say a 51-year-old employee, still in his uniform, killed five of his co-workers, then turned the gun on himself.
All employees that were on scene had been allowed to go home.
The sprawling brewery campus includes 20 buildings where officials say 1,000 people were working. Many remained on lockdown hours after the shooting stopped as police searched and cleared each building.
We are continuing our investigation in the recovery of the victims.
Nearby schools were placed on lockdown.
We just got an announcement, said school's on lockdown.
Parents tried to pick up their children.
Every street was blocked off.
And family members of Molson Coors employees rushed to the campus.
It's kind of upset, nervous, frantic, because I hadn't heard from them.
It all started just after 2 o'clock Wednesday afternoon with reports of gunfire in the area known as the Miller Valley.
They said to not leave the building.
Local and federal investigators were on hand, and Molson Coors executives traveled to the plant while political leaders offered condolences.
You think about the families of those individuals, people who just want to earn an honest living, and unfortunately will not be making it back home tonight.
Meantime, one employee asked the question on the minds of many across the country in the wake of yet another mass shooting in the workplace.
Why is this happening? You know, why does this seem to be happening so much more often than what we ever knew?
And in a statement this morning, the CEO of Molson Coors called this a, quote, unthinkable tragedy. Reporting live this morning in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, Mike Lowe, WGN News.
Thefts at gun stores are a problem here in Illinois and across the country.
It's prompting calls for federal legislation aimed at forcing gun sellers to keep firearms safe outside of business hours when thieves are most likely to strike. WGN's Mike Lowe examines why gun stores are easy targets.
All is calm at the Jesse Brown Veterans Affairs Hospital, but the chaos and panic of a single hour months ago still echoes.
He shot when he was outside like 8 times.
Active shooter.
One ticket of shots fired.
We all started running.
There's a shooter in the building. There's a shooter. Get out.
40-year-old Bernard Harvey Jr., armed with a long gun, allegedly fired shots outside and inside of the building. He was arrested. Amazingly, after all the shooting, not a single person had been injured. Chicago somehow avoided becoming the dateline of the next mass shooting in America.
I cannot tell you, with all the things that are going on in this country right now, how lucky we are.
But in the relief, there was a revelation. The incident cast a harsh light on another nationwide problem.
We learned this the hard way.
That night, federal agents traced Harvey's rifle to a gun store outside of Indianapolis, where just 2 weeks earlier, five burglars kicked in doors, smashed display cases, and scooped up more than 30 guns in 90 seconds. Gun store burglaries are becoming increasingly common. And guns stolen from surrounding states are finding their way to Chicago.
Following the trail of the firearm is what helps us lead to who the illegal purchasers are or the people that are burglarizing those FFLs.
FFL stands for Federal Firearms Licensee. It can be a person's home, a pawn shop, a gun shop, or a sporting goods store. ATF agent Christian Hoffman says criminals focus on gun stores for an obvious reason, because that's where the guns are.
Most of them can't purchase the firearms legally. So they see an opportunity to get these firearms from burglarizing an FFL.
It's a big problem. There's a huge inventory of firearms in all of these stores.
U.S. Senator Dick Durbin has proposed a solution.
A simple requirement: store your guns safely when you're closed.
He says the scale of the problem is astounding. If you took every single McDonald's in America and combined that number with all of the Starbucks locations in the country, then doubled the amount, you still wouldn't equal the amount of licensed gun dealers. There are some 63,000 licensed gun dealers in America selling handguns, rifles, ammo, and camo for safety and sport. Businesses that deal in dangerous products face strict federal regulations. For example, pharmacies have to store medications like opioids in locked cabinets. Yet most gun stores face no legal requirements to secure the weapons they sell.
When you look at the federal guidelines, we do not have the authority to dictate security measures for those licensees.
Criminals have heard the news.
10 thieves smashing their way inside.
Police believe it was the work of professionals.
This is where the thieves bashed their way into the gun store.
The theft of these firearms fuels that illicit trafficking, and once those guns hit the streets, there's no telling what can be done with them.
Do you think there is a need for federal legislation?
Well, we already are regulated by Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms with respect to how firearms are transferred.
But gun store owners like Dan Eldridge of Max and Shooter Supplies and Displays says new federal regulations would be burdensome for businesses like his.
There is no one-size-fits-all. Different stores display things differently.
Crime guns pose a risk to our communities and to our law enforcement partners.
And it's why officials say protecting guns inside of the stores is a way to keep people safe on the streets.
It is a top priority for ATF.
In Chicago, Mike Lowe, WGN News.